Thank you very much for joining us. My name is Wilson Mburu, and our sign language interpreter tonight is William Silla.
I'm Nancy Kachingera. Now, the government has finally moved to address the killings between the Turkana and the Pokot in that border area between Turkana and Baringo.
The Interior Cabinet Secretary Joseph Nkaiseri has announced an operation will be mounted in the area starting tomorrow to quell the violence.
Nkaiseri spoke as some of the first injured survivors to reach a decent medical facility gave harrowing accounts of the killings that started on Monday.
And as KTN's Dennis Onsarigo now reports, many children and women were among those killed in the 2 days of fighting, whose official death toll is yet to be released.
Survivors of the Monday morning attacks in Baringo County, emerging from a torturous 18-kilometer terrain. Spanto Dongor is lucky to be alive, but he needs urgent medical attention. Span has a bullet lodged in his body after a night of fighting involving two warring communities in Kadome and Kasarani areas in Baringo County. A local medical facility in Chelamongot paints a clear picture of a night in the hands of the attackers, survivors describe as one out to kill and not to steal.
Dungwa na kisu, na mingine unapasua kwa kisu tumbo, mingine unakata kwa kisu.
Those who came face to face with the attackers say there was an external hand in the ambush.
Kuna mtu anaweza goti. I've never seen a person who anaweka goti. I've never, this one kama ili ya nini, it's strange. So these people must be coming from ama sangine hao wali kondesha medisha kuna other places.
According to residents, the attackers were numbering more than 1,000 and descended on manyatas. Women and children were the most affected.
Nyumbani 11 na wa huko huko mstoni ni sana si 48
mpaka saa 4 mpaka saa 5 mpaka saa 8 paka saa 9 musho.
The number of hours that the bloodletting lasted. The local provincial administrators say the residents have been left on their own to die.
Usaidisi atujapata sababu watu ya security alikuja kupiga njani, hatuna barabara ya kupitika.
The killings have sparked off fears of more attacks in neighboring villages, forcing residents to flee to the nearest towns. The National Police Service has remained tight-lipped on the number of those killed and injured in the two-day fighting.
Now, the source of information about the losses that Kenyans are suffering appears to be coming more credibly from Red Cross and not the government of the Republic of Kenya.
In fact, the local police advance team say they have not come across any bodies. Back in Nairobi, the first official government response from the Interior Ministry.
The government is starting operation with immediate effect. The process will start. And if their leaders will be found culpable, they will face the full force of the law. The one numbers, by tomorrow, the people who will be on the ground, the operation kickoff, will be able to tell you, you know.
Despite the national government directing its energy to the expansive count in the last 6 months, the killing of innocent residents caught up in the conflict has not stopped. Denson Sarigo, KTN Prime.
Again, now the question of the government's response time, even in this attack, comes to mind. And the question is the government's response on Turkana Pokot killings timely? Was it timely? We still don't know how many people have died yet in this attack, and we still don't know whether more could have been done by the government either to avert this attack or even, you know, manage it to some sort of extent. So the question is, and this is the question we're asking, our big question tonight, is the government's response on Turkana Pokot killings timely?
That's right. A lot of our information has actually been coming from the Red Cross. Today, they said that they've counted 54 people dead. We're still yet to get official figures. But if you consider even the fact that the officer leading the administration police said as late as last night that they couldn't, they went to the place and they didn't see anything, so they couldn't actually give any authoritative information on these attacks. Tells you that there may be a gap in terms of just how quickly response is being made to this situation. We'd like to get your thoughts on this, whether you think this response was timely. You can do that by tweeting us at Kachungira, at Wilson underscore Mburu, at KTN News KE. If you'd rather send a message, do that. 22155, that's the SMS line, and you can also start with a yes or no so that we're able to compile your thoughts into a poll result for later. Well, right now, though, let's get a bit more from our reporter on the ground. This is Kamche Menza. She is in Marigat at the moment. Kamche, I hope you can hear me. Where are you in relation to the area that this attack took place, and what have you discovered?
Thank you so much, Nancy. For now, I'm quite a distance away from the area in which the attack has. And the situation there at the moment, if by yesterday the residents were, it was in some tension. Up until now, following the last response from the government, there is still some tension among the residents there.
All right. Sorry, it looks seem to be not getting you very well, but I hope you can hear me. Have you been able to speak to some of the locals? What kind of experiences are they telling you about?
Okay, we talked to the locals yesterday. The experience that we, what we have is that the residents in that area, it's a volatile area, most of the time, actually, this is not the first time it has been a day there. So being a part of the community, they usually have some of these ways. And to us, when we talk to them, what they told us is that most of the times when the raids come, they know how to, that is how they handle it. Because most of the time, it's usually an ambush from the other side. So their experience is that most of the time, that is not the first raid, so it's like they know how it happens, just that they were ambushed, and it really affected women and children who did not know where to run to. Most of them were found at their homes, as the men actually ran after the cattle that these raiders had come for.
All right. And what can you tell us about the response, specifically by the government? Who were the first responders on the scene, and how would you say the government has responded to the situation?
Nancy, we received the information. As journalists, we received the information on Monday afternoon. We tried to get some clarification from county top officials for security, but the information they were giving was also scanty. So on Tuesday morning, that is yesterday in the morning, we thought of rushing to that place. Once we got there, actually we were the first journalists to get on the ground. What we found there was an ambulance from the county government. And where it was located, it was a distance away from where the attack took place. And what they told us is that they were waiting for the injured people to be walked from wherever they were, because they were scattered, they were put in one place. So they were waiting for people to identify where they were, to take them from wherever they were to the position where the ambulance was on some medication so that they can receive treatment. By one or two, that's when we saw Red Cross and CEC for help, for community health in Baringo. They're the ones who were the first people to respond to the raid yesterday in the afternoon. By yesterday evening, there was still no response from I can say national government or police until this afternoon today.
Wow. Okay. Well, thank you very much for speaking to us. Kamche Menza in Marigat telling us that it was only earlier today that they were able to actually get a response from the government. Let's change tack now. Cord senators led by minority leader Moses Wetangula say that the Jubilee administration has no justification as to why they cannot protect the lives of Kenyans. They say that someone in the government must take responsibility for what is happening in Baringo, saying the tenure of the Inspector General of Police, Joseph Boynet, has started on the wrong footing.
Look at what is happening. 100 Kenyans are slaughtered. The president does not mention anything about it. The president does not even go there. The president does not do anything. In mature democracies, when such things happen, somebody somewhere takes responsibility.
But I'd like to bring it to the attention of the president. Kenyans' worst fears are as follows. That could it be that there might be an element of sabotage within the security organs in view of the fact that Boinet bypassed 400 senior police officers in landing his job as the IG?
Sisi tumekuja hapa kushutumu uzembe wa serikali katika kuimarisha usalama katika pembe zote za Kenya. Tumeona hivi jana katika hizi usiku mbili zilizopita kwamba halaiki ya Wakenya tena wamepoteza maisha yao na serikali haijafanya lolote ambalo lila kuhesabika.
We want to tell the government of Jubilee that very soon, if they don't watch out, we, the women of this nation, will not stop and watch our children and our mothers being massacred and killed in Pokot, in Turkana, in Samburu, and the other parts of the country, in Mandera and Garissa. We are going to mobilize our women and say no to this government.
Now, these killings in Turkana, Baringo and Samburu counties have been taking place despite concerted efforts to bring peace and find long-lasting solutions. Betty Kialo now takes a look at what has been happening on the ground, where church leaders are struggling to bring the warring communities together in order to stop the violence.
The latest killings, where young children, women and elderly men were brutally killed, continue to raise questions as to just what it will take to end the years of violence and death witnessed in this region. And even more worrying, the people on the ground, including church leaders, tell us that the violence that is reported on the news is nothing compared to what actually takes place on the ground.
Every day we have people killed down there in Kainuk, over there in Kapedo yesterday evening.
Border disputes and scarcity of resources here remain the biggest points of contention. Search for water and pasture here has led to what leaders describe as hatred between communities, with vicious stealing of cattle used as retaliation. With solutions to the unending violence seeming far-fetched, the Catholic Church decided to build a shrine in Lodwar, Turkana County, where hostile communities would be given a platform to come together and air their grievances.
People come there and go up and sit, some pray, some look out, some have something to eat.
The leaders also visit homes of the Pokot and Turkana to encourage peaceful coexistence. However, this noble act has been fought by deep-rooted hostility and lack of political will.
Ni watu sasa wanaenda kuvamia jamii fulani, lakini wakipata mifugo sio kwamba wanaweka, wanaenda kulipa mahari, la sivyo wanaenda kuuza.
At the moment, you go to Lokori in eastern Turkana, and for 100 kilometers, you go between there and Kapedo. You will see no human being, you will see no domestic animal.
Following the periodic attacks in the region, the leaders say there is a better way for the government to deal with the violence.
Deploy a big number of people, soldiers especially, along the borders, and especially in the Kenya area, go into Pokot, West, East, Turkana, and mop up the guns that are there.
The government has on numerous occasions promised to deal with the hostility. However, no concrete solution has ever been arrived at. The leaders here say their peace mission is here to stay until the two communities can live in peace. Betty Kialo, KTN.
Well, remember, our hashtag tonight is Nadome is Kenya, as we seek to highlight this seemingly forgotten area. We will have a story later on that seeks to find out just why it's so difficult to get information from that area. Now, the National Environmental
Environment Management Authority is pushing for the prosecution of owners of the metal refinery EPZ Limited over lead poisoning of Owino Uhuru residents in Mombasa. NEMA Director General Professor Geoffrey Wahungu says that NEMA has forwarded information to the Director of Public Prosecution seeking to secure a prosecution. NEMA officials were grilled by the Parliamentary Committee on Environment following the KTN expose Futaria Sumu on Dichopevu and the inside story's plague for profit.
10 days after the KTN expose Futaria Sumu on Dichopevu by Mohammed Ali and the inside story's plague for profit by John Allan Namu, which detailed the suffering of residents of Owino Uhuru slums in Mombasa due to lead poisoning by the metal refinery EPZ Limited, the Parliamentary Committee on Environment was seeking answers from the National Environment Management Authority. NEMA, which issued the metal refinery EPZ Limited with an operating license in February 2008, says it did not issue a battery recycling license to the company.
There was nothing wrong with the initial EIA because we issued the EIA for smelting.
NEMA issued a closure order to the factory on the 3rd of October 2013 following complaints over the operations of the factory. NEMA later lifted the closure order, and the Director General is blaming the Mombasa District Health Officer who gave the factory a clean bill of health and recommended its reopening.
We acted on their advice according to MCA and went ahead and opened the facility. Even if we wanted to argue, we do not have the mandate nor the expertise as ourselves to deal with this kind of issue.
Residents of Owino Uhuru affected by lead poisoning from the metal refinery EPZ Limited are still seeking justice. The polluter pays principle, which would have compelled the company to pay for its shortcomings, is yet to be effected.
As a committee, we are looking at actualizing the polluter pay principle in legislation by probably fast-tracking the regulations pertaining to polluter pay principle that's been pending.
NEMA says it is seeking legal action against those behind the metal refinery EPZ Limited.
We have been in constant communication with the office of the DPP and giving them information every day as we get it to actually secure a prosecution.
They should be taken to court, and after the matter is heard and finalized, then we should be able to quantify the amount of damage that has been felt by the members of the public and ask the person who is responsible to pay that as a civil action in a court of law.
NEMA has started a decommissioning strategy for the facility that has brought untold suffering to the residents of Owino Uhuru, for whom justice may be a long time coming. Rita Tinina, KTN.
Now, cancer is said to kill 60 Kenyans every day, killing more people than HIV, TB and malaria combined. The killer disease remains a big burden to the nation. The situation presents a crisis the government has set out to fight by launching a 21 billion shilling project aimed at acquiring the facilities for the treatment of the disease. And now Kenya is also set to host the 9th annual forum of African First Ladies Against Breast, Cervical and Prostate Cancer in July. Sharon Mbomanyi reports.
Phyllis Wangari is a woman in immense pain. 4 years ago, she was diagnosed with breast cancer, but the diagnosis was made late and she had to undergo a mastectomy. Sadly, the cancer had spread to the other breast. Her biggest challenge has been the difficulty in accessing the care she so needs.
Next week.
Phyllis is just one of many cancer patients who struggle with the high cost of treating the disease and the difficulty in accessing care due to very few facilities available in the country to manage it. But the Ministry of Health states that the 21.5 billion shilling project meant to overhaul and advance cancer management in the country is well underway.
The contracts were awarded, the companies have started work, and we told them that even before you pay them a cent, they must put pilot or model hospitals to show us what Kenyans you get from this project. And Your Excellency, we choose four hospitals, Machakos, we choose Kakamega, we choose Homa Bay, and we choose Thika.
The project, launched in February this year, is meant to see two hospitals in each of the 47 counties fully equipped with cancer treatment facilities. Health Cabinet Secretary James Masharia says there's even more.
We shall also be going ahead, and like Dr. Mulagudi mentioned, also now have radiology treatment centers. For this is a separate project which will be starting in July. And for that, Your Excellency, we are starting with four centers.
Kenya will host the 9th annual Forum of African First Ladies Against Breast, Cervical and Prostate Cancer in July, a forum aimed at bringing together the whole continent, joining efforts in the fight against the killer disease. To this end, First Lady Margaret Kenyatta Wednesday morning hosted a sponsorship meeting with private and public stakeholders.
The 9th SCCA conference creates a platform where stakeholders from various sectors can come together and share experiences in the fight against cancer. As the host nation of this conference, we must show our commitment to fighting cancer.
60 people die from cancer in Kenya every day, ranking the disease the third killer disease after infectious and cardiovascular diseases in the country, also making the fight against cancer a very critical one in the country. Sharma Manyi, KTN, Nairobi.
Well, let's go back to that story we're talking about tonight. Nadome is Kenya. That is the hashtag we're using. I just want to read a quick tweet here. Sylvester Ora says the reaction is agonizingly slow. Is the government going to build a wall between the Pokot and Turkana like it's doing with Somalia? And that's his two cents.
And the question now actually really is, so where is Nadome and where is Kasarani?
That's right. The border area between Turkana and Baringo has remained hard to access, and the information from there on the latest killings remains incomplete.
Edith Kimani now takes us deep into the killing fields and why all Kenyans should be very angry about the goings-on there.
On Saturday at around 5 p.m., an unknown number of armed bandits believed to be Turkana attacked a small village in Baragoi, Samburu County. 14 people died from that attack. Exactly 48 hours later, another group of armed bandits, also believed to be Turkana, raided a homestead in Nadome, 15 kilometers from the Baringo border, killing five family members. Those attackers were to be later waylaid by alleged Pokot gunmen, sparking this latest wave of fresh attacks. The attacks, which have claimed between 50 and 100 lives, all occurred within this radius. But violent attacks on Turkana have become almost synonymous. Turkana County, which is only second to Marsabit in size, spans some 77,000 square kilometers. Compare this to Nairobi's 696 square kilometers, and the sheer vastness of the county becomes clear. Nairobi can fit into Turkana 100 times over. In fact, Turkana is roughly the size of Narok, Nakuru, Bomet, Kericho, Baringo, West Pokot, Samburu, Laikipia, Meru, and Embu counties all put together. Yet, the conflict, as history shows, is limited to the county's border points. The first indication of how bad the bloodletting could get came in October of 2014, when 26 police officers were killed after they were reportedly mistaken for cattle rustlers. This was here, to the south of the county in Kapedo, where the Pokot from Baringo and Turkana from Turkana County share a border. But the invaders sometimes come from outside Kenya as well. Almost 800 kilometers from Kapedo is Todonyang, where in 2011, at this northeastern side of the county, over 30 Turkanas were attacked by the Dasanach, also known as Meriles, from Ethiopia. On the western side of the county, the Turkana have only hit a stride of sustained peace following years of conflict with Uganda's Karamoja. And to the southeast, perennial conflict rages between the Turkana and Samburu, with the violence centered in Baragoi and Suguta areas. Although the issue of livestock, particularly cattle rustling, has been blamed for the endless conflict, the raiders' weaponry and their level of preparedness has remained a key concern. Government's approach has been single and sustained.
Mimi silaha hizo ambazo zilichukuliwa kutoka hawa askari, mimi sitaki kugojea wiki mbili, nataka zirudishwe leo. Lazima mnajua wako wapi.
But that approach, it seems, has done little to end the violence. In fact, the region is now seen as one engaged in a vicious arms race where each community strives to amass as much weaponry as it can. The communities are also reluctant to give up their arms if no guarantee is given that their neighbors too will disarm. In the meantime, Nadome, Baragoi, Todonyang, Kapedo, and many other border areas continue to flare up at will. Edith Kimani, KTN.
The hashtag we're using is Nadome is Kenya. The big question is the government response on Turkana Pokot killings timely? You can SMS us on 22155 at Kachungira at Wilson underscore Mburu. We'll continue reading your responses as the bulletin moves along.
That's right. We take a quick break, but KTN Prime will be right back after this.
Welcome back. Thank you for staying with KTN Prime.
Now let's go to that battle of the sexes. Devolution Cabinet Secretary Anne Waiguru is making spirited attempts to counter a draft bill to postpone indefinitely the enactment of the two-thirds gender rule.
Now, Waiguru told the National Assembly's Constitution Implementation Oversight Committee that a counter-draft bill on gender parity was ready and should be discussed by Cabinet next week ahead of its tabling in Parliament.
But Chairperson of the Justice and Legal Affairs Committee, Samuel Chepkonga, has maintained that he will not withdraw his bill.
And we made a decision.
The National Assembly's Constitution Implementation Oversight Committee invited various ministries and commissions to know efforts made towards drafting various laws for implementation. Last week, Chairperson of the National Assembly's Justice and Legal Affairs Committee, Samuel Chepkonga, tabled the Constitutional Amendment Bill No. 3 that seeks to amend the Constitution to allow for progressive realization of gender parity. Chepkonga insists he acted within the law and will not withdraw the bill, as had been suggested by the Constitutional Implementation Commission Chair, Charles Nyachae. Devolution Cabinet Secretary Anne Waiguru said her office had already presented proposals of the Technical Working Group on Gender Rules to Nyachae Commission for review ahead of publication.
We made a decision that we would rather go with the amendment of Article 81B in the format in which it has been published and has gone through the first reading.
We are giving you a report about processing that bill, and then at the same time, a member of parliament, a parliamentary committee, on the same issue, is publishing a bill purporting to address the same issue. I think, you know, it begins to look a little a lack of seriousness on our collective part.
I think the CIC is blowing hot and cold on this issue. If they had something, I mean, I think the chairman has taken the bull by the horns and he has presented something. If CIC and the other actors were really serious, they should have come in earlier.
I've already submitted the bill to CIC and Kenya Law Reform. It is really up to them to finalize with it for us to be able to submit it to Cabinet.
Let's remain mindful of 27th August deadline. And if you come up with a draft proposal bill that would actually overtake some of the amendments they are proposing, I'm sure he's a responsible member who will be able to convince to maybe withdraw the relevant amendment.
On Monday, Attorney General Professor Githu Muigai wrote to Judith Ongori and company advocates stating that though the Supreme Court gave Parliament up to August 27, 2015 to come up with legislation on how the two-thirds gender principle will be met in the 2017 polls, What should be before Parliament for debate, enactment and assent by the 27th August, is the legislation to give effect to Article 100. Article 100 provides that Parliament shall enact legislation to promote the representation in Parliament of women, persons with disabilities, youth, ethnic minorities and marginalized communities. Later in her office, Anne Waiguru mobilized women and demanded that Chepkonga should withdraw his bill. Curiously, Waiguru never pushed that line when she appeared before Parliament.
We call upon the National Assembly to withdraw the proposed bill and urge that Parliament takes more time to consult with all parties concerned.
I'm sure the same bill that you have sent to the executive, when it comes, when it's read for the first time, it will be sent to the same committee. We will then consider. If we think that ours is moot, then we withdraw. If we think yours is moot, then we will ignore.
Speaking from South Africa, National Assembly Speaker Justin Muturi proposed the scrapping of women rep and nominated MP positions and instead have 100 nominated slots to address gender rule. What is Maendeleo ya Wanawake take on Muturi's proposal?
I believe that today, as we assemble together with the ministry and the commission, that we are beginning to win this war. And this war must be won.
Despite the August deadline fast approaching, the Constitution has allowed Parliament to extend it by a period not exceeding 1 year if it garners support from at least two-thirds vote by members. Patrick Amimo, KTN.
Well, a very good evening and welcome to KTN Business. My name is Abi Agina. The Central Bank Monetary Policy Committee has retained the benchmark lending rate at 8.5%. The decision comes amidst rising inflation and a weakening shilling, but the bank says inflationary pressure was not demand-driven to warrant action this time round. April inflation rose to 7.08% as food prices during the month spiked. The MPC linked the rising inflation to development in the foreign exchange markets, which threatened the bank's price stability objective. The central bank rate has been retained at 8.5% for the past 2 years, with the MPC trying to balance between the need to keep the shilling stable and also growing the economy at the same time. Last month, the central bank announced it was ready to step in to cushion the weakening shilling. CBK says it had $6.8 billion in foreign exchange reserves for 4 months import cover at April, enough to cushion against temporary shocks. And on tonight's edition of The Adventurer, Kenya's annual housing shortage is estimated at 150,000 units, with low-income earners being among the many who cannot afford to put a decent roof over their heads. The shortage has, however, reflected as an opportunity for Joseph Mutua, who is now fabricating cargo containers into houses in Nairobi's industrial area. KTN's Charles Kitonga has more.
When you want to construct a house, you think of timber, iron sheets, brick and mortar, but probably not this, a cargo container.
My name is Joseph Mutie Mutua, and Containers Kenya, we started the three of us. We are in the business of selling containers, adding value to containers, that is fabrication. Based on customers' dictates and needs. Basically, it's a customer who walked in and he said he wanted to buy a container from us, but besides the container, he wanted to fabricate it to make a clinic. He asked us if we had that capacity. And with the designs that the customer had, we worked on the first assignment, which was fabricating a 20-foot container to make a clinic, which we did successfully.
What goes into making a decent house out of these containers?
The customer comes with a mental picture, with a concept. What do I want from the container? If it is a house, you'll ask for the drawings. Yeah? Now, from the drawings, we'll give it to a technical man who will now fabricate the 40-foot container or 20-foot container to make what the client desires. What is very unique about
containers, it's the time it takes to achieve what you want. Normal work will take us from 14 to 21 days. We have delivered. The cost compared to building, the costs are far much less. I would say, what would with a container to fabricate to make a three-bedroom house, it will cost you in the region of 1.5 million. A one-bedroom house that will be made comfortably from a 1x40-foot container, that will cost you 750,000. This is a 40-foot container. From these 40-foot containers, we'll put them two containers side by side with a view of fabricating a three-bedroom house. We'll cut the middle part. This is about 15 feet, yeah, and put them side by side. What you'll be walking through will be the living room. What you're seeing in my extreme right is one of the sitting room. The other sitting room will be there at the other end of the container. And the other end of the container will have another bedroom. That makes them three bedrooms. What you're seeing in my left here, this is where the washroom will be. You understand? From this end, we'll make a kitchenette area here at the back. Well, what you're seeing here, these are the MDF boards. We'll put these MDF boards across the container, around the container. We'll put also styrofoam with a view to regulate the temperatures. So when it's very cold, you don't feel it. When it's very hot, again, you don't feel it. Yes. When we started this business, fabrication was never part of our costs because fabrication is the need of the customer. If a customer comes with the need of fabrication, he will finance for that. Yeah. So our initial finances to start a container was about 200,000. If Kenyans have a mind shift, they accept that you can have a house from a container, and it's not a quote-unquote a Mabati house. Yeah, because we associate Mabati house with low-class people or a measure of poverty. If people appreciate that you can have a decent house from containers, I believe we'll be able to do a lot of business.
It is what I would call an innovative business, transforming a cargo container into somewhere you can call a home. Charles Gitonga for The Adventurer.
Well, indeed, thinking outside the box, a unit going for 1.5 million, quite affordable. Well, moving on, first quarter banking results continue to trickle in, with Kenya Commercial Bank today announcing 12% growth in net earnings. During the three-month period, KCB saw its net profit grow to 4.3 billion shillings, ranking it at par with its closest competitor, Equity Bank, which announced a 4.2 billion shilling profit last week. KTN's Joy Dorimbira has more.
We're down on our interest in our foreign exchange income.
It's been a busy first quarter for banks, with results indicating growth in the sector in 2015. KCB, Kenya's largest bank by assets, continued on that profit growth momentum with 4.3 billion shillings in net profit. This attributed to the 11% jump in interest income from 8.3 billion shillings last year to 9.3 billion.
So far, close to a billion shillings of loans, like 100 million worth of savings.
Net loans and advances to customers rose from 233.7 billion shillings to 297.03 billion shillings during the quarter, while customer deposits stood at 397.1 billion shilling. As of March, KCB's total assets were up 34% to 510 billion shillings.
We launched our product, if you remember, in March, about enabling customers access credit and then giving them a chance to make savings. So we are not going to kick on more the saving culture for our customers.
Already, the bank has unveiled its insurance and Sharia-compliant banking arms as a way to boost income. Investment in technology is also likely to drive the bank's growth in 2015. KCB has two mobile-based banking products, KCB M-Banky and KCB M-Pesa, which already have 1 million account holders.
it's an exciting space for growth for our businesses.
Of the banks that have announced their results, Equity Group posted a 10.7% net profit growth to 4.2 billion shillings, while Cooperative Bank posted a 29% growth in net earnings for the same period, raking in 3.17 billion shillings in net profit. Joy Doreen Bira, KTN Business.
Many thanks there, Joy. And moving on, Kenya is looking to double her trade by 2016 within Africa, even as trade volumes within the continent continue to soar. Speaking during the launch of the 10th World Trade Organization meeting, President Uhuru Kenyatta rallied manufacturers to grow their exports in Kenya. Trade within Africa has been relative despite the enormous potential it possesses. But recent trade statistics paint a rosy picture.
The integration of Africa into the multilateral trading system complements Africa's regional and continental efforts towards increasing intra-Africa trade.
Kenyan exports to Africa surged by 4% in 2014 to hit 241 billion shillings, driven by increased purchases by countries such as Ethiopia, the DRC, and South Sudan. The president now says that growing continental trade should be the focus for manufacturers who can pin their goods on lower production costs.
This is the way to go for us as a continent to realize the dream of the continental free trade area.
The government is currently working on bringing down the cost of power, with the key focus on increased generation capacity to lower production costs for manufacturers. Kenya will in December host the annual World Trade Organization ministerial meeting, using the platform to negotiate not only with its continental peers, but seek new markets overseas.
It's a further manifestation of Your Excellency's commitment to promote conference tourism and investments in Kenya.
We should use this conference to agree on a work program that can guide members to conclude the Doha round of trade talks and deliver development as promised in the Doha Declaration of 2001.
Well, and that brings us to the end of today's KTN Business. Coming up next is our financial report. And just that you know, Safaricom will also be releasing its results tomorrow. Do have a good night. My name is Abby Gina. Take care. Good evening and welcome to today's edition of KTN Sports. My name is Moses Wahisi. Starting us off, many will agree that Gor Mahia remains on course to retain the Kenya Premier League title. The side bagged three crucial points away in Awendo against Sony Sugar after securing an important 1-0 victory. The all-important solitary goal was notched in by Ali Abondo. The Green Army foot soldiers are 7 points ahead of the second-placed Thika United, are yet to lose a single match in the KPL season this year. The national under-23 football team admits that they require a miracle to overturn the 3-0 deficit during the second leg of the African Youth Championships qualifiers in Botswana. The youngsters must win by the tie by 4 goals. And coach Bobby Williamson says that that target is very achievable.
The Kenya under-23 national football team has a Herculean task ahead as they seek a ticket to the 2015 Africa under-23 championship. The team conceded 3 goals in their first leg match against Botswana in Gaborone almost 2 weeks ago. The loss, however, has not dampened the spirit in the youngsters' camp as they host Botswana this weekend. The youngsters are hoping to put their best foot forward as they seek to overturn the deficit.
We've got 90 minutes to get 3 goals. They scored 3 in 45, so I'm hoping we can score 3 in 90, but goals are hard to come by at the moment. It seems hard, but we'll get the 3 goals coming on Saturday.
The national team head coach is also seeking to have players that are on club duties back in training before the crucial encounter.
That's the aim. That's what we've got to try and achieve. But you know, it won't be easy. We're not a team that scores a lot of goals. And it's difficult when the main striker, Michael Olunga, is away playing for Gormaya today.
Lakini tusipate kufungwa bao hata moja, kwa sababu tukifungwa bao moja itakupatia tena pressure nyingine kubwa sana. So lazima on the defense, lazima tu defend vizuri na tuangalie vile tunaweza funga.
The Junior Zebras are expected in the country on Thursday. Despite suffering a 3-0 loss in Botswana, these youngsters feel they have what it takes to topple their opponents this weekend. Robinson Okenye, KTN Sports.
Thank you, Robinson, for that piece. And now, the Kenya football legends are blaming the current players' negative attitude, poor leadership, and lack of proper grassroots talent-tapping system on the declining standards of football here in the country. And as Hassan Juma reports now, the legends' observation comes after the recent national under-23 3-0 loss to Botswana in the Africa Youth Championships.
These are some of the players who sent shockwaves in the region beyond during their heydays, either at club or national assignments. The seven players, former Harambee Stars and Kenya Breweries winger Eli Adero, Joshua Controller Morella, Tobias Juakali Ochola, George Songote, Peter Dao, Ben Musuku, and goalkeeper John Busolo launched the Nairobi Champions Cup. But what is now left of Kenyan football are memories of years gone by, when Kenya was a soccer powerhouse.
Kwanza wakati wetu tulikuwa tunacheza kwa ajili ya furaha ya mchezo. Lakini wakati huu hali ya fedha na kazi imeingia katika mpira.
The current crop of players, the attitude is not right. And from my point of view, I can say that might be the money issue came at the wrong time.
It's very sad tukiona sasa tuna let the foreigners from outside kuja kucheza hapa. Whereas sisi tuka, at least ni tuko na wachezaji pia.
That Kenyan football has been dogged by mismanagement and lack of proper grassroots infrastructure is not in doubt. The retired players believe Kenya has enough talent which needs a new approach to inject fresh power to the national team Harambee Stars.
Ile tumeanza kuangalia kutoka roots, hizo ndio roots za mpira pale chini, na ile ningependa sana pia tuingilie pia youth. Wale watoto wadogo pia tuanze na wao.
Football is at the grassroots. And what is happening here is to promote the youth to come up.
The seven veteran players are the ambassadors of the just launched Nairobi Champions Cup. Hassan Juma, KTN Sports.
Right, well, let's wrap up this bulletin with a reminder of our big queue. This evening we asked you whether you thought the government's response on the Turkana Pokot killings was timely, and we have a poll result right now on your screen. You can see
83% of you say no. Well, 17% of you only, 17% say yes. Let's see, let me get a tweet here from Inspire, Engage, Motivate, who says it looks like cattle rustling. It's a big money business. Please screen animals sold to KMC. That is one person who has a very different view of this thing. Mm-hmm. Leaders should come together, avoid politics to save local mwananchi. Above all, let's all keep on praying. That is Francis Kayemba.
There's an SMS here from Walimu Ababu Muhongo from Lanet. Thank you for writing in. You say Nadome is Kenya? No, because the government seems not to be determined to protect lives in that area. It's as if the people in that area are wild animals. Well, thank you for sending in your opinion. And here's a no from Dan in Eldoret. You say the response was slow. If they pushed Al-Shabaab beyond Kismayo, they can do the same in this now hostile northern part of our country.
The hashtag we're using tonight is Nadome is Kenya, which is indeed Nadome is Kenya. So that conversation continues on Twitter. Keep your comments going on Twitter. JKL is up next, I believe.
That's right.
From here at the Standard Group Center on Mombasa Road. Enjoy the rest of your viewing. My name is Wilson Buru. Have yourself a good night.
William Silla was our sign language interpreter. I'm Nancy Kachingira. We'll see you tomorrow. Good night for now. Enjoy JKL.